प्रणाम, नमस्ते, गुड इवनिंग, हाउ यू गाइज डूइंग? आई होप ऑल ऑफ यू आर स्टेइंग होम, स्टेइंग सेफ, टेकिंग गुड केयर ऑफ योर सेल्व्स, वर्किंग हार्ड फॉर योर एग्जाम्स, एंड मोस्ट ऑफ ऑल आई होप दैट यू आर हैप्पी. प्लीज कन्फर्म इफ आई एम ऑडिबल एंड विजिबल. हेलो प्रशांत, आई होप यू आर हैप्पी विद द न्यू पिक्चर. I am okay, just give me one moment please. Yeah, let's begin. So today we're going to discuss something very, very interesting, something that you might not have thought of. Now the article that I have picked up for today is huge, and it took me a lot of effort to cut it down to a size that is doable in this half an hour span that we have, and it was all the more difficult to come up with questions. So because I have cut down a huge article to almost one third of its size, I'll give you a background of how the author started, because the starting was beautiful. I had to remove it with a very heavy heart, because I just couldn't fit it in the, you know, slides, because if I included that, then I would have to leave the important points. So the author begins by saying that he knows a cat in the neighborhood who's not very welcoming and not very friendly. If you have a cat, or if you know about cats a little, you know that almost the entire cat family except lions are not very, I would say, friendly. And they travel, or they walk, or they live solitary lives, okay? So then Bill or Billy something was the name of the cat. And this guy shifts into a new home, and the landlord and the cats want to move away. So when the landlord packs up and puts the cat into the car, the cat doesn't want to leave. So the landlord somehow pushes the cat into the carrier, okay, and then goes away. And halfway somewhere, when they're extremely away and moving towards Brooklyn, which is the new house of the landlord, very, very shifting, this cat, you know, starts pushing the door of the carrier and jumps off the carrier. Now this guy is driving, and he is unable to, you know, push the cat back inside the carrier. So he's confused. So finally he had to stop his car, and he stopped his car and he wanted to put the cat back in the carrier in the car. So he opened very, very carefully, opened just 2 inches of the door, and from those 2 inches, that cat Bill just jumped off, and there was a 70 mile per hour traffic going on, and it was a very busy road, and this cat just jumps and runs so fast that nobody can catch up with him. And then he just disappears. And finally, the landlord with a heavy heart had to go to his new home, thinking that he has lost the cat forever. And after some weeks, this guy who is the author, in fact, it's not a guy, it's a woman, Catherine. She writes that she was half asleep and somebody was, you know, fiercely making noises at her door. And she wakes up in the morning and she's half sleepy. And she sees that there is a dirty gray colored cat at the door, and then the moment she opens it, she realizes that this is the very same cat Bill who was taken far away from the house. And she offers him food and everything and asks him like an idiot, "Are you Bill?" and the cat doesn't respond, obviously. So she clicks a picture and sends to her landlord that, "Is this cat Bill?" And the landlord, you know, takes a car and drives all that distance and comes in. The moment the cat looks at his landlord, he just jumps into his arms, and all of them get emotional, and then finally the food that was being offered by the author was eaten. The important question that the author is asking here is, how come this cat, after all that traveling, without any GPS, without any knowledge of the streets, amidst all that traffic, absolutely intact in one piece without any injury, comes back to her same old house? So the topic that we are going to discuss today is, why don't animals get lost? How is it that they travel huge distances without ever needing a map? Let's dive deep into this beautiful, beautiful article. True navigation is the ability to reach a distant destination without the aid of landmarks. The true navigation is not what you do. Okay, you navigate. This is true navigation. You can reach a distant destination and you do not have help of landmarks. Okay, if you were kidnapped, now imagine this, taken in pitch darkness, thousands of miles away, and abandoned somewhere uninhabited, so nobody's staying there, it's uninhabited. True navigation will be your only option of finding your way home. To do so, you will need a compass. Along with it, you will need to know how to use it. So using a military compass or the compass that they use in forests and military, it's not everyone's cup of tea. You need to learn how to use it. For instance, you should have the awareness that the magnetic North Pole and the geographic North are not identical. I'm not sure how many of you actually knew this before reading this here. So the magnetic North or the geographic North is also known as the true North, and magnetic North are two different things. So you should be able to discriminate between the two so that you can use the compass. Failing that, you would need to be able to orient. Orient is to direct yourself based on the movement of the sun, which is again a tricky business. So now, I usually take a lot of, whenever we're thinking about directions could be about where should I keep my hand or where should I keep my medicines, all that vastu stuff. If you are into it, I'm sure you follow the sun all the time. But it's again a tricky business, because if you don't know the latitudes, which means if you're in the southern hemisphere rather than the north, things are going to change, right? So if your kidnappers are not kind enough, even sun is going to be problematic, because you need to know where you are, what latitude you are in. If you plan to travel after dark, you'd better hope that you aren't in the southern hemisphere, which has no equivalent of the North Star. So in the northern hemisphere, you have Dhruv Tara, the North Star, yes? But in the southern hemisphere, you don't have that equivalent. You don't have a South Star. So you will have to be able to rival Galileo. You have to compete with Galileo in his knowledge of nightly and seasonal course of constellations, because everything changes. The sky changes with seasons. The sky changes with months and everything. But even if all this applied, you would still be in trouble if you did not have a map. Being able to maintain a given bearing with perfect precision is not much help if you have no idea where you are vis-a-vis your destination. So if you don't know where am I right now, and you want to go to your house, let's say your house address is G99 Rajouri Garden. When you don't know where you are, how will you decide which direction to walk in? You have no clue. So it's very, very difficult. Cats, bats, elephant seals, red-tailed hawks, wild beasts, gypsy moths, cuttlefish, slime mold, emperor penguins, to one degree or another, every animal on earth knows how to navigate. And to one degree or another, scientists remain perplexed by how they do so. Perplexed is confused, puzzled, bewildered, baffled. Some animals plainly do have a map, Abhi. Or, as scientists call it, a map sense. So they do not literally carry a piece of paper or a phone with them. They have a map sense. An awareness, which is mysterious in origin, of where they are compared with where they are going. This is a mystery. How do they know where am I? And how do they know in which direction I have to go? Obviously, the cat was not watching where is my driver taking me. But then she still knew how to come back. Maybe it took her a little time, but she was back. For some of those animals, certain geographic coordinates are simply a part of their evolutionary inheritance. We were talking about, collective unconscious yesterday in the psychology class. It's a part of your evolutionary inheritance in case of some animals. You just have it in you. Sandhoppers, those tiny excitable crustaceans that leap out of the way when you stroll along the beach, are born knowing how to find the ocean. So if you've been on a beach and you've seen sandhoppers, okay, you've seen grasshoppers, I'm sure there are sandhoppers also. So if you are walking on the beach, they will clear the path, they will not come your way. You leave them guys anywhere, these guys will come back to the ocean. They just know how to find it. When threatened, those from the Atlantic coast of Spain flee the west, while those from its Mediterranean coast flee south. Flee is escape. Even if their mothers were previously translocated and they hatched somewhere else entirely. Mummy kho gayi hai. Mother is translocated. Eggs are somewhere else. The eggs hatched somewhere completely different. Yet, whenever they have a sense of danger, depending on where they are, on the Atlantic coast or the Mediterranean coast, they will choose their direction. Ki kahan jana hai. Likewise, all those birds that embark on their first migrations alone must somehow know instinctively where they are going. See, I can say that birds learn it from their parents. They travel in flocks when they are migrating. But sometimes some bird, when it travels alone, must know which direction should I take. But instinct alone does not explain what such birds can do. In 2006, scientists in Washington State trapped a group of white crowned sparrows that had begun their annual migration from Canada to Mexico and transported them in a windowless compartment to New Jersey. So you can't look outside, okay? this is an avian equivalent of the kidnapping through experiment. So again, the kidnapping experiment is being done here, but this time with whom? Avian creatures. Avian creatures are the creatures who can fly, which means birds. Okay. So let's see, what do they do? Upon release, the juvenile birds, those making their first trip, headed south along the same bearing that they had been using back in Washington. How do they do it? At present, the most compelling theory is that they make use of the Earth's magnetic field. We know about this ability because it's very easy to interfere with it. So, you know, the Earth's magnetic field can be disturbed. For example, when you leave pigeons, when you release pigeons on the top of an iron mine, they don't know where to go. They will be terribly disoriented. Disoriented means they get lost. They don't find a direction. Why? Because in an iron mine, the magnetic field is completely different and it's very strong. So the birds can't find their way. Until they find their way out of it, they are confused. So they lose all sense of direction, which means they are somewhere being influenced by the Earth's magnetic field. I can see a few questions from some of you, Sanathan and Ashutosh. I think you will have to wait for those answers till the end of the session because I have to complete this. Okay. When scientists went looking for an explanation for this and similar findings, they found small deposits of magnetite, the most magnetic of Earth's naturally occurring minerals, in the beaks of many birds, such as in dolphins, turtles, bacteria and other creatures. Abhi ye bhi bade kamal ki discovery hai. Scientists were trying to find out how are they operating with the magnetic field of the Earth. What did they found? What did they find? They found that there is a naturally occurring mineral in the Earth which is known as magnetite. You also find it in beaks of birds, dolphins, turtles, bacteria and other creatures. This was a thrilling discovery, quickly popularized by the notion that some animals might have built-in compass needles. As with many thrilling and popular scientific ideas, this one started to look a little strange on closer inquiry. So they were very quick to jump to a conclusion, oh, this means that they have a compass needle. But then it was very strange when you inquired further. Why? It turned out that birds with magnetite in their beaks were not navigating based on the north-south alignment. See, if you are using a compass, how do you work? You work on the basis of north and south. North is the most important direction. Okay? As we humans do when using a compass, instead, they were relying on the inclination of the Earth's magnetic field, the changing angle at which it intersects with the planet's surface as you move from the poles to the equator. All physics, geography lost. They are not using simply the magnetic field. They are worried about the inclination of the Earth. And this is something that constantly changes when you travel from the poles to the equator. It's not something that is constant and you just know it and you move in that direction. Inclination provides no clues about polarity because it's constantly changing. If you could sense it, you would know where you were related to the nearest pole, but you will not know which pole is the nearest. So maybe you will know that where relatively am I moving towards the pole or not, but you will still not know which pole is closer to me. So maybe you think you're moving closer to north, but you're actually moving closer to south. Whatever the magnetite in birds is doing, then it does not seem to function much like the needle in a compass. So this theory is not working. One possible explanation for this strange phenomenon lies in a protein called cryptochrome, which is found in the retina of certain animals. Retina is in your eyes. I am sure you know that. Even researchers who study the relationship between cryptochrome and navigation do not yet exactly know how it works. And some of their colleagues question whether it works at all. Baki mein kaam karta bhi hai ki nahi karta hai, they are not sure. True navigation, which was once thought to require the kind of advanced reasoning and sophisticated tool making exclusive to humans, seems increasingly likely to be a widely shared capacity. Now, this is very sophisticated. Sophisticated here means complex, complicated, elegant. Yeah. And the kind of advanced reasoning which is required to be able to travel such long distances without getting lost. We thought that we are the ones who have it. Actually, we share this capacity with a large number of species. Countless bird species can do it, and so can salmon. Salmon is a fish. Those conga line, this is my favorite example. Just read about this, it'll blow your mind. Conga line rock lobsters are so good at it that they appear to be impossible to disorient. Aap inko hila nahi sakte. Aisa hona chahiye cat crack karne ke liye. We know this because scientists have gone to outlandish lengths to try to do so. Outlandish lengths is like, you know, crossing all limits. They've done a beautiful experiment. There's a book called Super Navigators in which Barry describes, you can cover a rock lobster's eyes, put it in a non-transparent, which means opaque container, filled with seawater from its native environment. That's how you make him survive. Line the container with magnets, okay? So magnetic field is also gone. Suspend it from strings so that they swing in all directions. Magnet se bhar do pura. Put the container in a truck. Drive the truck in circles on the way to a boat. Steer the boat in circles on the way to a distant location. Drop the lobster back in the water and voila, it will strike off confidently in the direction of home. I can only think of the song Nadan Lobster Ghar Vaapis Aaja. So they are such experts at this and we have been unable to find out how are they doing it. Needless to say, you and I cannot do this. In the very first paragraph of the slide, not in the original article, the author has said that you and I need maps and compasses and stuff to travel. If you blindfold human subjects, you take them on a disorienting bus ride, you leave them off in a field, remove the blindfolds and you ask them to head back where they started, they will promptly wander off in all directions. They will not know what to do. If you forgo the bus and the blindfold, so you leave it out. Forget the bus and forget the blindfolds. And you ask them to walk across the field towards the target. And then you conceal the target after they start moving. They will again go off course in approximately 8 seconds. So if you just left in a field, okay? The challenge is now smaller. And we've shown you a target and we ask you to walk towards it. And when you start walking, we just hide it for some time. You will see that you will have no clue where to go because there are no landmarks, no identification signs, and you will forget which direction am I walking in. You can't walk straight for more than 8 seconds. The problem is not that humans don't have that innate wayfinding tool. We too can steer by landmark. So no, that's how we find out our ways, and this is why we have landmarks in our couriers also. And we can locate the source of sounds. So if you're calling me from my left side and I pay attention, I know that you're calling me from my left. Or other environmental cues also. And we can make our way towards them. We do this like frogs. So we are similar with frogs here. How? We unconsciously assess either the intensity differential. So if I know that the sound is more intense, it means I'm moving closer. If it's getting feeble, it means I'm moving in the wrong direction. Similarly, there is a time delay between a noise in my right ear and in my left one. So if my noise, if the sound is hitting my right ear first, it means the source is here. And if it's hitting my left ear first, it means the source is here. We also have a host of specialized neurons in the nervous system to help us keep oriented. Head direction cells, which fire when we face a certain way. Place cells, which fire when we are in a familiar location. Grid cells, which fire at regular intervals when we navigate through open areas, helping us update our own position. So our nervous system is the most complex. Everybody knows this. Mammals are above everything and then humans are the superior among mammals. Now our neurons start firing. Firing means sending signals. It's all electrical. We've discussed this yesterday as well. So when we are moving in a certain way, when we move our face in a certain way, when we find a familiar location, our neurons will tell us whether we are going right or wrong. And we have boundary cells which fire in response to an edge or obstacle in our field of vision. So yes, our nervous system is helping us. But still, we are not able to do it with the same expertise as these lobsters. Many indigenous people of the far north were wonderfully adept. Adept is skillful. It's not adapt, it's adept. At navigating terrain, terrain simply means earth, that most of us would find all but featureless. Featureless terrain means you can't mark on a tree, you can't notice a specific mountain, you don't have a hand pump. No, featureless earth, nothing. The Inuit, which is the name of a tribe, for instance, made their way overland using extensive systems of landmarks and could navigate coastal waters in dense fog by means of careful attention to wave patterns and bird calls of their home cove. What are these pygmies, these tribal people using? They are humans. But what are they using? They are using bird calls. They are also paying attention to wave patterns. And then even dense fog cannot stop them. By the 4th century BC, the Greeks had made their way to the Arctic Circle. By the 2nd century AD, the Romans had reached China. And by the 9th century, Indonesians had landed in Madagascar. As time went on, we began supplementing observation and memory with more and more physical tools. So up till now, what we were using observation. And what else? We were using memory, right? With more and more physical tools. The astrolabe, the sextant, the compass, the map, the nautical chart, and the GPS, global positioning system. These are the tools that we started using. So earlier our only tools like animals were probably observation and memory. Now we are using all of these tools perversely. Perversely is when you want something to happen but something else happens which is not fine. It is partly because these tools got so much better that so many of us got worse at navigating without them. It's like, so we were using silbatta, okay, to make spices and chutneys in Indian households. Then came the mixer grinder. Now we are so used to using the mixer grinder that our muscles are not that strong, or we are not as good at using silbatta anymore because we have shifted our capacity to a less, to a more convenient thing or to a less demanding thing. So we are so used to it that we have gotten worse at our skills. Our skills have gone down. The ubiquity of GPS enabled maps has all but eradicated the need to orient on our own. So why do you need to worry? You just ask me my address and you come home in half an hour. You will not ask me anything simply because you're using Google Maps. Obvious landmarks, written signage, public transport system which tell you which bus is going where, cab drivers, throngs of locals. Throngs is large number of people. They offer directions. So you have so much of help that you don't need to remember the way to any place, to any destination. Rivers that were once easy to follow. So in the olden times, people used to follow the course of a river. Now rivers are being lost. They are rooted underground. You're building a dam or the river is lost because of global warming. The movement of the sun is hidden. It's largely obscured. Obscured is not clear. I've discussed this word earlier. Why? Because you have patli galiya and lambi lambi imarate, tall buildings and narrow streets. 99% of Americans live someplace where light pollution has reduced sometimes to just a handful the number of visible stars in the night sky. So we've discussed this joke earlier. Delhi mein you see 100 gram sitare, you see 100 grams of stars, that's all. And when I went to Kashmir, I saw maybe a kg of them. So it's a different experience. So the amount of pollution that we have, it does not help us watch the stars either. So this is why we have lost that orientation as well. Social norms are another cause. We know from countless studies that the more children explore the world, the better their sense of direction. But how far are they allowed to roam on their own? It has declined drastically in just 2 or 3 generations. Those factors take a toll on our navigational abilities. I'll tell you a small thing. So I was teaching a young child until a year ago, and he was in the 10th standard last year. He's very happy that his board exams have been cancelled. He lives 3 kilometers from my place, and he never came to my place alone to study, simply because he was not allowed. He could afford a car and a driver and everything, and that's how he used to come. When we were children, we used to go up to 8 kilometers on our own. The younger generation is not allowed to explore on their own. So then those factors take a toll on your navigational ability. Compared with neighborhood maps drawn by children who regularly walk or bike means cycle, maps drawn by children who are driven everywhere, they are woefully impoverished. Woefully is sadly, woe means sad, and impoverished means gareeb, kharab, okay. It is not just our own navigational capacities that we humans are endangering. Our increasing urbanization, over-reliance on automobiles, ever more distance relationship to nature is wreaking havoc on the ability of other animals to get where they are going. Wreaking havoc means causing a lot of damage. Illegal logging is destroying the mountain ecosystems of western Mexico, where monarch butterflies overwinter. So if you were destroying the landscape where an animal pauses while migration, how will the animal migrate? Because they need time to rest, they need landmarks to be able to find out. You're destroying all of them, how will they travel? Glyphosate, one of the world's most commonly used herbicide, is interfering with the navigational ability of honeybees. So the herbicide that you are using, the logging that you are doing, which means you are cutting down trees. Our cities have lights all the time. And then of course we are doing a debate every Diwali whether, you know, bursting crackers is nice or not, and New Year is nice or not, and Shadi to Atishbaji, very important. And then we want everything to be very well lit. Have you ever read about light pollution? If not, then please, that's your homework for today. Our cities are so well lit all night that it is confusing, and it puts these animals in danger. Imperiling means jeopardizing, putting them in danger. And they are drawn to light, okay, or they rely on stars and they can't do it anymore because there is so much of light that they cannot see the stars. They do not have telescopes like us. And as we appropriate more and more land for cities and for timber and agriculture, the portion available for these species grows considerably smaller. And then there is climate change, which poses by far the greatest threat to the customary movement of animals throughout the earth. No species is unaffected. Everybody is affected by climate change. But long distance navigators are at the highest risk, particularly at risk. Going to the last slide and then a few questions. If there is a silver lining to any of this, agar kahin koi ummeed ki kiran hai, if there is hope, and one must look hard to see it, dhoondna padega. There is no hope. You'll have to be really, really particular about finding it. As you are unable to find out the stars, it's not easy to find them. It is that the more we learn about how animals travel, the more we can help them in doing so. Knowing that salmon follows the scent of the natal stream, scientists added an odor to their hatcheries. Hatcheries is where the eggs hatch. And used it to lure. Lure means attract the fish back to the Great Lakes. Years after pollution levels there now ameliorated. Ameliorated means made better. Caused a local extinction. So salmon got extinct for some time from Great Lakes. But they use a scent which is from their natal stream. Natal is like birth stream. If you use that scent, they will come back because they use it to come back. That's their cue. So if we knew about this, we can help them. So that's the gray, that's the silver lining among the dark clouds. If we know that peak songbird migration is happening only for 6 to 7 days in an area, ornithologist means a bird watcher or a person who studies birds, they have made successful efforts that they dim their lights in those 7 or 6 days so that it becomes better. Knowing that a shorebird migrating 20,000 miles a year uses less than a single square mile of land has helped conservationists engage in smaller, affordable, effective preservation. So again, hum zameen bacha sakte hai because all that it needs is just a single square mile of land. The chief insight to be gleaned from how other animals make their way around the world is not about their behavior, it's about our own. The wayfinding we must learn to do now is not geographic, it's moral. You're morally bound to do it. I hope you enjoyed the article. Let's do a few questions and I'll also answer the questions that you have written in the comments. These are the upcoming courses for May. Please check them out on my profile at the Unacademy app or website. And tomorrow Saturday, I have a free class for all of you at 12:30. We are going to do a test. RC and VA questions combined. You just have to use code Karishma Live and you will be able to unlock this class for free. So those of you who are saying we can't afford a subscription, etc., at least you can do the free classes. These are the subscription rates and I think after all your research, you will come to know that these are the lowest rates in the country. A 6-month subscription would be good for you if you're a 2021 student and you're taking only CAT. If you're taking all the other exams, maybe 12 months, 2022, 24 months. This is the amount of EMI you pay and you use my code, you get a further discount. You can also try the scholarship test. It happens on Sunday at 12 p.m. Who knows that you might get a huge discount there as well. To be able to take the test, you can again use my code and log in. Question number one, write down your answers please in the live chat. Ashutosh, to know the syllabus of CAT, you can do my free classes. You go to my profile on Unacademy, use my code Karishma Live and watch the free classes. Watch free classes like how to prepare for VARC, Ground Zero RC. They are free. You will come to know detail mein kya padhna hai, kaise padhna hai, what is the syllabus and everything. Sanatan Dharma, if you don't want to take coaching, you'll have to do self-study and of course YouTube videos and special classes which are free will help you. Divyanshi, cats usually go here and there roaming around. They come back usually. Sometimes they don't. सेकेंड लास्ट पैरा की लास्ट लाइन मैं कर दूंगी रिपीट आदित्य सी आंसर कहाँ बता रहे हो आंसर ये है भाई 1, 2, 3 और 4 व्हाट इज द क्वेश्चन इट सेज विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग डज नॉट एक्सप्लेन The mystery of how birds and animals don't lose their way, which means you have to find a reason which is not a reason. Some species have evolved and instinctively known their paths. Yes, true. We've done it in the beginning, evolutionary involved. Yes. The magnetite in their claws, no. The magnetite in their beaks, chonch mein hai, panje mein nahi hai. and it does not guide them like a compass. This is also wrong, false. The protein called cryptochrome in their retina is an amazing aid. No, it's not. The scientists are not sure about it. How they use it is still not known. The research is going on. It's false. Some species rely on stars and scents. Yes, we did that in the last paragraph. Okay, so we have to find that does not explain, which means A and D explains, B and C do not explain. So the answer will be 2. Understood? If you solved it correctly but you marked A and D, it means you did not read the question properly. I hope this is clear. Chalo, let's do the second one. Krishna, good to see you here. Further application question. Hurry up, we're short of time. Come on. One, three, four, bucket two क्यों छोड़ दिया? Okay, let's see. This is a further application question, but the clues are there in the passage. Which of the following, according to the author, can help modern humans improve their unaided navigating capabilities? You're not using any aid. It has to be natural. Letting kids explore the neighborhood alone? Yes. He says that it is going down generation by generation. If you allow children to roam around on their own, they will learn how to navigate. But we don't let them go. We're too possessive about them. Practice using GPS and navigating tools is wrong. These are aids. Talking to throngs of locals about their areas is wrong. The author says that throngs of people are ready to offer you directions. And this is why you're relying on them, which means you do not have a capacity of your own. This is wrong again. Watching and following stars in the night sky, yes, it helps. Shuru mein bhi likha hai, Galileo se seekh lo, constellations, right? North star ka position. So they give you a clue. So if you know how to watch the stars, you will know how to walk in the right direction. So A and D, both are fine. Then my options are wrong. Yeah, so the answer will be A and D. My bad then. This should be A and D. Let's mark this. Okay. ठीक है, आई होप दैट्स क्लियर. सॉरी फॉर द इनकन्वीनियंस देयर. चलो लास्ट क्वेश्चन. Last question. That's okay. 1, 2, 3. Hello, hi, hyper gaming. Okay. Science section of a newspaper. A scientist research paper? No. A scientist will not write in his research paper that researchers are unable to find this and researchers are able to find this and researchers are unable to do this. If he is a researcher, he'll say we. Okay, so that's wrong. It's not a scientist, it's not a research paper, and he will not give you personal examples like cat, the one which I told you in the beginning, nor will he write personal stuff like you need to rival Galileo. You cannot do that in a research paper. You have to be absolutely formal in a research paper. An ornithologist's website, blog? No, wrong. We're not just talking about birds. We are talking about other species. We're talking about salmon and lobsters and animals. An ornithologist is only concerned about birds. A circumnavigator's account? Definitely wrong. A circumnavigator is somebody who takes a tour by water throughout the world. Somebody who sails the world by sea. So nothing to do with circumnavigation. So all of these are wrong. First is the answer, and that's also the source of the article. Why animals don't get lost, the New Yorker. This is a 26 minute read, now that you have read half the article or at least one third of the article with me, it should take you somewhere around 22 minutes maybe. Okay. Do the reading assignment that I've shared on the Telegram channel. Read this article completely as your homework. Okay. And revise RC basics so that when you have RC intermediate course on 17th May, you can join me live. The next session will now be held on Tuesday, which is 11th of May. These are the new batches happening at Unacademy. You can enroll yourselves. And of course, you can use an Ask the Doubt feature. Whenever you want to enroll yourself or buy a subscription, you can simply use my code KarishmaLive and get yourself a discount. That's all from my end. I hope this has helped you. And I have answered your questions. Thank you, big fan, small fan, AC. Thank you everyone for your love and affection. It keeps me going. I'll see you on Tuesday. Today you have a class with me at 7:30 on Odd Man Parajumbles. I'll see you there. Till then, take good care of yourselves. Bye-bye.